So welcome, everyone. I am Julia Nichols. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I live in St. Mary's County in the occupied land of the Piscataway tribe. I am the treasurer of the Southern Maryland group, and I'm the committee chair of major annual events for the chapter.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Shruti Bhatnagar. My pronouns are she, her, and hers. I live in Montgomery County in the occupied land of the Piscataway tribe. I'm the chair of the Montgomery County group and co-leading this evening with Julia Nichols. So glad to see you all on the call today.
Tonight is our legislative victory party. We will celebrate big wins for the environment, hear from some of the legislators who helped in our efforts, and thank everyone who helped us with Lobby Week. We were excited to read all the comments that came in from the responses for tonight, all of the things that you all are looking forward to celebrating. So we hope you will all join us in raising your glasses to toast our victories and put on your party hats if you brought your party hats, and get excited about the wonderful things we had done for the environment. I want to start off by welcoming Delegate Mark Corman this evening. He is not able to stay with us for the evening, but we're glad that he could come on from District 16 to say hello. And I can't see where he is on my screen, but I'm sure he'll give a wave. And we're happy to have you even for this short amount of time. There he is. Yes. Thank you for joining us and thank you for your help this session. Okay, I have a couple of housekeeping details. If you have any technical difficulties, give a call to Gary Young. He's at 301-277-7111. That is the Sierra Club office number. So that you can find that online if you need. Also, I'm just going to ask everyone to try to keep yourselves on mute because we have a bunch of speakers this evening, and it will help us to keep the noise level down, but we will try to have some, you know, celebrating, toasting things as we go out throughout the evening. A quick thank you to Katie Jocelyn with Maryland Relay for captioning our meeting tonight. And finally, we encourage you to share social media posts about the event. Hashtags are going to be posted in the chat. Oh, yes, there they are. And don't forget to tag us at Sierra Club MD as well. And Shruti, back over to you.
Thank you, Julia. During our Lobby Week kickoff event, we mentioned the Sierra Club Growing for Change Equity Task Force that has been actively engaged in propelling structural change by working to address principles for democratic change, anti-racism, examining power and white privilege, and implicit bias. In our legislative activities, testimonies, and in forming collaborative alliances to embrace diversity and inclusivity in our outreach and advocacy efforts. In the 2021 legislative session, the Sierra Club team made successful strides in its advocacy by supporting legislation and presenting testimony on non-environmental bills that are important from the lens of equity and social justice, such as the police reform bill, prevailing wage, and ranked choice voting. We worked more on outreach with other organizations to strengthen relationships, be more inclusive, and add a diverse perspective to our advocacy. Climate issues most disproportionately impact communities of color and low-income communities. In recognizing that, it is critical that impacted communities be in the front and center of our advocacy. Sierra Club submitted testimony to legislation led by other organizations and worked in collaboration with them to deepen our engagement on equity, inclusion, and justice. Today, as we celebrate some victories and some losses, we thank everyone who worked with Sierra Club to help us in this effort. Thanks to everyone who shared wonderful feedback and comments, recognizing the legislators and volunteers. We appreciate the overwhelming response and look forward to sharing those with you at a later time.
So one thing that we're doing here throughout the evening, we're going to be posting some trivia questions. We had asked our legislators who were on the call tonight to provide some answers to some trivia questions for us. So we'll have some of those come up on the screen. And what you'll do, what'll happen is you'll see a poll question on your screen that you'll have about 1 minute to answer. Then we're going to reveal the guesses and tell you the correct answer. So let's dive in here to our first question. Which legislator's greatest fear is not...
She locked up. Which legislator's greatest fear is not getting 100% rating from the LCB?
Getting 100% rating from...
Jeopardy music.
Yes, we should have thought of that. You can sing for us, Rosa.
I knew Spice was on the call.
All right. 3 more seconds. All right. Here we are. And our guesses are, so we have, I'm going to have to use my glasses for this. So 11% for Corey McRae, 17% for Mark Corman, 44% for Brooke Learman, and 28% for Paul Pinsky. And whoever answered Mark Corman, you're the ones who win. Although we don't have any prizes, but hooray!
That's funny.
Is that all right. What you're really afraid of?
All right, with that, I would like to introduce Mark Posner, our legislative chair and member of the Sierra Club Maryland Executive Committee. Mark is a retired civil rights attorney and will be presenting information summarizing the big wins and difficult losses on the legislation Sierra Club supported in the 2021 General Assembly session.
You're on mute.
Okay, maybe we can stop practicing saying that very soon. So anyways, thank you so much. I brought along a little bit of something to celebrate here. We just had a tremendous session. It was an extremely challenging one, as I think everyone knows, certainly the legislators know, very intense. And very different doing it, quite a bit of it over the internet, and then all of the protections they had to follow to make sure. And then amazingly, I don't think anyone got ill, so it was very, very successful in that regard. This session, the Sierra Club continued its commitment to address nearly every facet of environmental issues, whether it's clean energy or transportation or toxic substances, zero waste. Of course, many, many groups, we work with many groups and many groups specialize. We try to cover the whole territory, which is very, very challenging, but we do that through our dedicated volunteers and our staff, and also working very closely with other organizations, especially through the CCE organization. So if you could put the slide up that shows many of the bills that passed, we ended up testifying on in support of about 112 bills and 50 of them passed. So we've listed here only some of the issues. We didn't list all 50 bills that we supported, but you can see that there were many, many important advances that, and of course, these were things that were passed by the General Assembly. On almost everything, we're still waiting for the other shoe or whatever to drop from Governor Hogan. He did have a signing ceremony today. And I think there were a couple of bills that we had supported that he signed, including for example, the expansion of the net metering cap, which was very, very important for solar energy. So I'm not going to read every single issue here, but I think you can see them. Certainly, funding for transportation through the Transit Safety and Investment Act was one of our priorities. Transition to electric buses, support for electric cars. Another big bill that we've been working on for several years to have the PSC to consider climate as well as labor issues when they make their important decisions. Black liquor is no longer going to, well, again, this is what the General Assembly has opined. Black liquor is not going to receive any more subsidies. Community choice energy for Montgomery County. A lot of zero waste issues, including increasing composting. The million trees planted by 2030, protecting the Chesapeake Bay, greater protection against lead in school drinking water. That's a Jared Solomon bill. And I think also Senator McCrae, and actually that was signed today by the governor. So congratulations to them. Strengthening the Maryland Commission on Environmental Justice. And then as Trudy mentioned, we also supported bills, non-environmental bills on policing, protecting our democracy and protecting essential workers. So we have a lot, as I said, we have a lot to celebrate. Of course, there were things that didn't pass that we supported, important bills that were issues that we're going to continue to work on, such as regulating the forever chemicals, PFAS. The bill that we've been working on for several years about transitioning our communities away from coal and supporting workers and the communities impacted, unfortunately, did not pass. The Environmental Constitutional Right Amendment, important transportation reforms, didn't pass. And then something that also particularly for us, a couple of things, of course, the Climate Solutions Now Act, though parts of it were then passed through separate bills, and the Plastic Bag Reduction Act, which we thought was going to pass last year and then got hung up when the legislature had to close early. Again, well, it passed the House, but didn't come out of committee in the Senate. So that was very disappointing. So lots of things to still work on, but overall, I think a tremendous session, many, many positive things. So a lot of thanks to our volunteers, our staff, to the legislators, to the legislative staff who I know work so hard. So I think that covers it. I think I'm going to, there's the prompt for thanking our staff. Josh Tulkin, I think you all know, has been director for, I don't know, maybe 10 years. Gary Young, our administrative assistant, you saw earlier. Losa Zenebi, who works on coal issues. Lindsay Mendelson, our indefatigable transportation policy person. Paula Posis, who came on about a year ago as our deputy director, and Laura Limley, who's really personifies the chapter and has been part of the chapter for many years. So I'm going to turn it over to Rosa Hans, who's standing there holding a bunch of carrots. Not sure what symbolism that has, but they're very green. So she's been chapter chair for, I guess, since January 2020, as you see on the screen. And she's been a fantastic chair, very enthusiastic, has helped broaden our work and helped us in particular focus on equity and really engage a new generation of leadership within the chapter. So with that, I will thank you and turn it over to Rosa.
Thank you so much, Mark, for the kind introduction. And while there wasn't any particular symbolism behind my my carrots. I was really proud of the garden that I grew last year, and I'm outside in my garden right now. So again, thanks so much to you and to our hosts, Julia and Shruti, for putting this together, and Lindsay for running the slideshow, and just to the whole team. And in particular, thank you so much, Mark, for the enormous amount of effort that you put into your role as legislative chair, and particularly this year, as we're all adapting to new procedures in place and virtual, and for the last 5 years in your role, building up our core of testimony riders and doing an enormous amount of the administrative load, tracking bill status, and really practically providing us real-time updates at times to our leadership team, as well as our coordinated check-ins. So before I begin my remarks here, I wanted to acknowledge and thank all the legislators who are here in this meeting, and as well as all of our guests. It's wonderful to see so many faces on a Zoom after the legislative session this beautiful evening. So thank you all 80 of you, and I'm going to see if I can say thank you and acknowledge each of our senators and delegates who are here with us tonight. Senator Ben Brooks, thank you so much for joining us. I see, well, I got to go into gallery mode now. Chairman Kumar Barve, Senator Corey McCray, thank you for being here. Delegate Jared Solomon, Delegate Heather Begnall. I see so many people. I'm going in alphabetical order, and here we go. And I see, oh, thank you, Delegate Boyce, Delegate Regina Boyce, thank you for joining us. And thank you, Senator Chris West, Senator Ben Kramer, Senator Sarah Elfrith, Senator Susan Lee. It is an honor to have you join us this evening, and we really appreciate the work that you all do in the General Assembly. We know that sometimes during session, we're, you know, calling your offices all the time, but we really appreciate that you answer and that you're here for your constituents and keeping the environment and climate and justice in the forefront of the work that you do. It makes our job as advocates and constituents much more pleasant to know that we have allies and folks who care about these issues deeply personally as well as professionally, who are fighting for us on the floor of the House and Senate. And there may be others who I've lost on there, but I'll just say thank you. Thank you very much. I'd also like to take a moment now to recognize this month in celebration of Asian American, Native Hawaiian, and Pacific Islander Heritage Month. May this be a time to celebrate and honor the leadership and contributions from our Asian American and Pacific Islander friends, family, neighbors, colleagues, and esteemed guests who have been powerful catalysts for change in Maryland, at the Sierra Club, and other progressive organizations. Within Maryland, Sierra Club, I'd like to take a moment to recognize several change makers who are working to build a world where everyone has access to clean air, clean water, a stable climate, and healthy communities. So first, our host, Shruti Bhatnagar, who's a chair of Montgomery County Group, Maryland. Shruti is currently the chair of that group and serves on the Maryland Chapter Task Force for Growing for Change. She's been a membership chair, recruiting, building local teams of volunteers in various conservation efforts, leading orientations, facilitating and moderating discussions on myriad topics from solar siting to transportation equity and engaging youth to build the next generation of leaders. And I'm so glad to call you a friend and a colleague, and thank you for everything that you do. And the next person I would like to highlight is our beloved chapter coordinator, Laurel Imlay. And I think I saw you out there somewhere, Laurel, and your dad. Hi, Mark. We are so lucky to have you as our chapter coordinator. And Laurel is the person who first welcomed me into the Sierra Club about 4.5 years ago. And that's what she does. She has been working and welcoming people into the Sierra Club since 1998 and currently coordinates the email communications calendar, supports the local groups. And she's so passionate about getting outdoors and getting fresh air while climbing mountains and riding bikes, saving trees, composting, weeding invasive alien plants from her yard, and eating garlic mustard, and swimming, boating, dancing. She's wonderful. And Laurel, we're so happy to have you as our chapter coordinator and all of the energy you bring to the club. Thank you. And the third person that I'd like to highlight, oh, hi, Laurel, you just popped up. Ling Tan is a longtime Sierra Club member and volunteer who is probably best known in the Maryland Sierra Club for her leadership in the pesticide-free yards campaign that began starting in her home county of Montgomery County, and it became a statewide effort several years ago. In 2017, you may recognize the signs, the Be Free Yards, and more recently, Ling helps track local and state legislation, participates in the Maryland Pesticide Education Network, Smart on Pesticides Coalition, and has written testimony and prepared social media in pesticide-free public health campaigns. So thank you all. Everything that you do, and happy Asian American Pacific Islander Heritage Month. So the list of volunteers that we have that is so long and so extensive that I can hardly read it. We had to make the font so small. I want to thank all of you for being involved in our legislative efforts throughout this session. In particular, I want to thank the teams of volunteers who work so hard to make big changes and a lot of new faces on this list. So I want to highlight a couple. Natural Places team grew its legislative work group under the coordination of Chair Lily Fountain. Hi, Lily. And the Zero Waste Committee tracked, wrote, and delivered oral testimony on over 10 bills. And this was something of a new record for volunteer leadership engagement by longtime volunteer and committee chair Martha Ainsworth. I lost Zoom. Hopefully, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I can't see you, but I'm here. The legislative committee tracked legislation and coordinated on strategy, timing, and messaging. Our social media team, led by Ashley Cobaugh, and a wonderful group of students from the St. Mary's College of Maryland, brought snippets of testimony and live tweeting bill hearings and sharing real-time updates. And we tweeted something like 195 times in February alone, which I was very proud of. And thank you to the Growing for Change Task Force for helping us implement some system-wide changes to take bold action to address both the climate crisis, collapse of biodiversity, plastic pollution crisis, systemic racism and injustice, the suppression of the civil rights to vote, and ultimately, we want to hold the corporate polluters accountable for the mess that they have created, and all of you have really contributed to that. So, thank you all. And now let me turn it over to our chapter director, Josh Tolkien, who will be joining us via video this evening.
Hi, everybody. I'm Josh Tolkien. I'm the director of the Maryland chapter of Sierra Club. I'm so sorry I can't be with you tonight. I had an urgent family situation, but I did want to take a moment and just share my gratitude with all of the volunteers and all of the legislators and all of the Sierra Club leaders and community members who came together this last legislative session, this tough legislative session, to fight for strong environmental policies, have some big victories, have some tough losses. I want to thank Mark Posner, our legislative chair, and Rosa Hance, our chapter chair, for helping to organize all of our volunteers together. We had over 120 bills that we did testimony on involving dozens of volunteers. We brought over 300 people together through our lobby week. Online, over 10,000 people took action on more than 10 different bills. Basically, we saw a huge growth in activism. Later on tonight, you're going to hear about all of the victories and the bills that we worked on and the legislators we worked with. But first, I just want to say that the energy that we brought together and all of the involvement and the time and the dedication from volunteers across the state, that alone is a huge victory. At a time where the pandemic threw up roadblocks left and right, you all helped fight to make sure that people across Maryland had a voice to fight for strong environmental policy. And I couldn't be prouder to be helping to lead this organization, and full of gratitude to our volunteers and to all of our legislative champions who are fighting to give us strong legislation to fight for. Thank you very much.
All right, we're gonna launch another poll here. Another trivia question for you. Which legislator collects Japanese samurai swords?
You did not warn us how hard these trivia questions would be.
Well, they're supposed to be just funny things that people don't know, and you're making a guess. And learning some fun things about our legislators as we go.
On this one bottom sheet missing.
All right, three more
seconds. A front runner there.
There definitely is. Okay. Whoops, I almost relaunched it. Okay. And so here we are. And the winner of the poll is Senator Ben Kramer. And that is the correct answer. So hooray for you.
That's a surprise. And I will share with you, the oldest one dates back to the 1400s.
Wow. Cool. And just for those of you who are interested, Delegate Mark Corman is working on a collection of foam fingers from minor league baseball teams. Senator Paul Pinsky has a collection of pottery. And Delegate Brooke Learman, her prized possession is a campaign poster given to her from Senator Edward Brooke, who she was named after. All right, back to you, Shruti.
Thank you for that fun trivia, Julia. I hope everyone enjoyed that. With that, I would like to now introduce Chris Stevenson from 1199 SEIU, who is going to talk about the Essential Worker Protection Act.
Thank you. Thank you so, so much, Rudy. I really appreciate that. And I'm very happy and pleased to be here to present to you all the Maryland Essential Workers Protection Act and tell you all what happened, where did this even come from, and so forth, and to tell you the outcome of this legislation. So I want to start by saying, like we all know, this piece of legislation that 1199 drafted came from the pandemic. We knew that so many work and so many industries were going to work, and they weren't really given the things that they were needed in terms of protections and safety standards and so forth. So 1199, as a team, we sat down and we drafted legislation that we thought would provide the best central protections for workers. What we came up with were various provisions, but even before I start talking about the provisions, I wanna talk about the coalition. We knew that it wasn't just healthcare workers that were going through some of these difficulties and the illnesses that came with COVID-19 and so forth. We knew that so many workers outside of healthcare workers were dealing with this. So what we did, we made a very, very large coalition. I think one of the biggest coalitions 1199 has ever had of different unions, of different progressive organizations, forth to tackle this legislation and give workers those protections. So now you heard the why. I want to kind of go into the provisions as well as give acknowledgement to our sponsors, Delegate Derek Davis, as well as Senator Malcolm Augustine. When coming to write this piece of legislation, there were six major provisions that we wanted to include. The first were safe and hygienic working conditions. We believe that no matter what essential worker was reporting to what work site, we wanted to make sure that that worker had a safe and hygienic working environment. That also included making sure that there are sanitation procedures as well as free PPE. We all know how effective PPE has been on holding back COVID-19. The second provision was hazard pay and healthcare assistance. Many of you all know that when a worker reports to work, they're putting their lives on the line, right? It doesn't matter if they're reporting to a hospital or they're a grocery worker or they're a bus driver. They're every day, they're going into work, putting their lives on the line. And we believe that hazard pay had to be something that workers were given, as well as healthcare assistance. If I got sick, if you all got sick, if a family member got sick, we believe that the Maryland Health Benefit Exchange should be open during this time to ensure that people receive the proper medical care throughout this pandemic. The next provision was an emergency action plan. We don't know when another COVID incident would come again. What we knew was that we needed a plan in place at every work site to make sure that not only the employee, but the employer knew what type of standards, what type of operation procedures, when it came to PPE, when it came to hours of work, would I be able to telework and so forth, making sure that there was an emergency action plan at every work site to make sure that the employer and the employee knew what the proper procedures were during this pandemic, but also if another pandemic were to hit. The next provision was universal health and bereavement. It's very unfortunate, but we all know that many in Maryland have passed away due to COVID-19. That's just the reality of the situation. We also know that due to the high amount of deaths, that bereavement leave and quarantine leave were needed. So we fought long and hard to make sure that we put this provision in, because we know that during pandemics, right, in order to keep a pandemic from spreading, that workers need to take off that time to get tested and seek medical attention. But also, if a family member were to pass away, that worker deserved that time to be with their family and to bereave that loss. So that was another important provision in our bill. The next provision was very simple, but a lot of legislators also had a problem with it. It was the right to refuse dangerous work. We believed that if an essential employee were to report to a work site, that they could tell their employer, listen, the conditions of this work site are not safe. They're not hygienic. It makes me, as a worker, an essential worker, able to obtain COVID-19. We wanted to make sure that workers had that right, that they could refuse that work. And certainly, last but certainly not least, it was the right to free testing and reporting of positive test results. We didn't believe that any essential worker, no matter what work site they were reporting to, should have to pay for testing, right? We wanted to make sure that the Maryland Department of Health actually were tracking the high amount of cases in different industries and so forth. So as the public, we could know where these cases were occurring, as well as where resources should have been allocated. So those were the six major provisions of the bill. And I want to talk about kind of what happened during this legislative session and so forth. As you all know, many of our legislators had a tough fight against them. This was one of the busiest legislative sessions, which also encompassed a lot of bills. which also meant with a lot of fiscal policies and fiscal impacts that were attached to them. But when it came to this bill, when it came to the Maryland Central Workers Protection Act, there were a lot of provisions that were strict, especially during a lot of the subcommittee meetings under the Economic Matters Subcommittee of the Business Regulations. So a lot of provisions were taken out. It was very unfortunate. One of the biggest problems was funding. Hazard pay, unfortunately, was not able to be passed in that piece of legislation because there was simply not enough funding that legislators said around the state to be able to pay for hazard pay. Unfortunately, that was one of the biggest provisions that here at 1199 and also our coalition partners wanted to fight for, because we know and we understand that hazard pay, it continues to be something that workers need, especially knowing that a lot of essential workers are actually now having to pay more for groceries, for transportation, for childcare. The list goes on and on, but the cost of living has also risen throughout this pandemic. So I now want to kind of talk about the outcomes. The bill did end, and the governor still has yet to sign the bill, but I want to talk about the outcomes that were left in the bill when the bill did pass both the House and the Senate. Fortunately, we do have safe and hygienic working conditions that was kept in the bill. So essential employers are required to provide a safe working conditions for employers. An emergency action plan is required. It will be set forth by the Maryland Department of Health to issue a template for a lot of essential businesses to use. Universal health leave did pass in a certain type of capacity. It now requires the federal government to give funds to the state that would give funds to businesses, essential employers to give to the employees when it comes to taking health leave. The right to refuse dangerous work was also included in that legislation, as well as the right to free testing, which would require essential employers to provide free testing, like I said, unless testing is available somewhere else. The Maryland, as many of you all know, MOSH and OSHA also have a provision in this bill that will require MOSH to develop an emergency temporary standard if OSHA does not solidify an emergency temporary standard within the 2 weeks after the effective date of this legislation. So that was the outcome. We were happy with some of these provisions, but of course, some of the provisions that we were gearing for did not pass. But the beauty of this is that we do have next session to come back and to fight for some of these provisions. Last but not least, I want to say, and I want to give a very big, big thank you to the Sierra Club for partnering with 1199 and the rest of partners. I was talking to Josh, as many of you all just heard just a moment ago, and this was a very unique relationship where we, both Josh and I, and here at 1199, I'm sure at the Sierra Club, we know that healthcare and the environment are very well intertwined. We know that a lot of our healthcare workers experience a lot of different situations, not only within themselves, but also the patients because of environmental issues. So here at 1199, we are very proud to have the Sierra Club as a partner, and we really look forward to working with you all in the future. Legislation that affects both of our communities. So with that said, I don't want to take any more time because I know there's a long list of legislative victories, but from here at 1199, we want to thank you all. Here at the Sierra Club, we want to thank you all for being part of our coalition, and we look forward to working with you all in the future. Thank you so much.
Good evening. This is Teresa Ball. Can you guys hear me very well?
Yes.
Thank you. And we will hear now from Senator Chris West and Delegate Ben Brooks.
Good evening, everybody. I'll start, and I'm going to leave much of the substance for Ben to talk about this bill. He can talk about why the bill failed. I'm going to talk for a minute about what we accomplished, even though the bill failed. So this is the second year this bill has been brought. This is a bill to wean Maryland from burning coal in order to generate electricity. And when we started this two years ago now, there were six facilities left in Maryland that burned coal to generate electricity. And so and when I say we, it's the primary lift was done by Josh Tolkien, David Smedic, and Jen Brock Cancellari, who engaged these companies in continuing conversations and let them know we were going to be introducing a bill to require them to shut down. In the process, negotiations ensued. And last summer, one of the six shut down abruptly. The Dickerson facility in out of Montgomery County shut down. But the negotiations then resulted in commitments, publicly announced commitments by all of the facilities that still burn coal in Maryland to shut down within the next 9 years. So this summer, the facility at Chalk Point on the Patuxent River will be shutting down its coal burning furnaces. They have other mechanisms to generate electricity, but the coal portion of it will be shutting down. In 2025, whatever that's, four years from now, there are two major facilities on the Patapsco River just outside the Key Bridge. They're both gonna shut down. In 2027, the last two, I played a role in myself involved in the negotiations. 2027, the Morgantown facility on the Potomac River, where right next to the 301 bridge goes across to Virginia, that will shut down. It is a major facility. And we negotiated with them, and the agreement is that they will shut down in 2027. And then finally, there's the Warrior Run facility. They call it clean coal, but it's not really very clean, out in Cumberland, Maryland. They have a contract to forward electricity to various companies. And they came to us and said, if you make us shut down before 2030, we will renege on our contract and we're going to get sued. So we said, fine, stay up until 2030, shut down in 2030. So even though the bill didn't pass, much of what we wanted to accomplish has been accomplished through negotiations with the companies. And now, Ben, I'm going to lateral the ball to you and you can tell them why the bill failed.
Okay. Well, thank you, Chris. Just for the record, I'm Ben Brooks, delegate here in the 10th Legislative District, Baltimore County. I serve on the Economic Matters Committee, and I chair the Public Utilities Subcommittee. As Chris just said, we fought like tigers on this bill. One of the sticking points was the fact that Labor did not want date certain on when those plants were going to close. I thought it was going to provide an off ramp, to allow those impacted workers to receive some level of compensation, as well as those impacted counties. There were primarily four counties involved: that's Anne Arundel, Prince George's, Montgomery, and Washington counties. So when those plants retire, of course, that's going to impact their taxes, property taxes. Yeah, so here again, the goal was to make sure we provided some funding for those impacted workers. And the goal was to get those funding from SEIF, that's the Strategic Energy Investment Fund. We had targeted about $39.9 million from that over a period of 3 years, labor was not at all satisfied with the fact that we were setting a date certain, and we sort of thought that was at least allow some assurance in the sense that the folks who were being impacted, they knew what to look forward to and would allow them to plan accordingly. As Senator West just said, we want to transition from coal. And as we all know that 40%, about 40% of the electricity is generated from coal, but 80% of the CO2 emissions comes from coal, So it becomes win-win. We could reduce our carbon impact, our carbon footprint, but at the same time, being able to transition onto something else. The reality is that coal is going to phase out. That's just a reality, And I think once we start facing that particular reality and trying to do things to move forward, then it all becomes a win-win for all the stakeholders that are involved, you know. I also think too that the owners of these particular coal-fired plants, you know, it's a business decision for them, you know. There were not anything that, say, the legislators or, you know, we were doing to say, hey, you got to shut this plant down. I think they were making those decisions based on their business models, and they're facing the reality that this old dirty fuel is definitely phasing out. Yeah, so that was the goal. Yeah, we fought like tigers on this. You know, I think, you know, once we get the stakeholders re-involved, re-engaged and come up with the concerns that they had, and I think perhaps we could move forward on this, and then make sure that the state of Maryland become the victor from these efforts. Thank you. All right. Oh yeah, I did want to say one other thing. I wanted to thank Rosa for elevating me from the House of Commons to the House of Lords. Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Okay. Ben, that was a demotion.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thanks. Thanks, Julia, Sharuti, Mark, Rosa, and all who are involved. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Senator West and Delegate Brooks. We are on to our next trivia question, which is a little bit of a throwback. Here we're asking, what was Delegate Jared Solomon's first job? And I will let you know that all of these were first jobs of somebody.
Bias is chiming in from the peanut gallery.
All right. Got a couple more seconds and we shall see who's got this one right. All right, for newspaper delivery, we have a 25%, but that was the first job of Senator Cory McCrae. Car wash was the first job of Delegate Mark Corman. Retail work at Sears was the first job of Senator Paul Pinsky. A clerk at Drug Fair was the first job of Senator Ben Kramer. And shoveling snow was the first job for Delegate Jared Solomon. Mowing lawns was the first job for Delegate Brooke Learman. So those 16% of you who guessed shoveling snow, good for you.
I'm glad we got to learn everyone's first job.
Yes, it makes it fun that way, right? And then you can remember it for, you know, future trivia games. All right, we'll turn it over to David Smith.
Awesome. Thank you, Julia. Good evening, everybody. My name is David Smedek. I use he, him pronouns. I'm a staff member with the Sierra Club, zooming in to you all from Baltimore tonight. And I have the distinct pleasure to briefly introduce Senator Ben Kramer from District 19 in Montgomery County. You know, a longtime climate champ, Senator Kramer has sponsored a whole bunch of bills and supported a whole lot of bills in the environmental and climate space. And this past year, and for actually 2 years in a row, he sponsored a really critical bill that we've worked closely with them on to ensure that the Maryland Public Service Commission is considering climate and fair labor standards in their decision making when they're approving new power plants, when they're considering how to regulate our electric and gas utilities, and all sorts of really important work. He gets credit for passing the bill twice out of his committee, as last year it was stuck in and got thrown behind the COVID early release of the General Assembly. But this year it is fully passed through both chambers in his partnership with Delegate Laura Charcutian from District 20. And my pleasure now to hand it over to Senator Kramer. Thank you, Senator.
David, thank you for that. I appreciate it. And good evening to everyone who's here and to all my colleagues from the legislature who do such great work. And my thanks to the Sierra Club for all that you do to support the environment and improve the environment and bring the notion of the reality of the climate crisis to our legislature and our local government, our federal government. We still have climate deniers, and that manifests itself every time we try to work on legislation to address the climate crisis. The bill that David just made reference to had considerable Republican opposition as it went both through committee and on the floor in both chambers. So it shows there's still a lot of work to do. Briefly, the bill basically did four things. The first is there's what's called a power plant research program. And it's located in the Department of Natural Resources, and they are required to evaluate environmental considerations with regard to power plant site evaluation. Under the bill, they will now be required to also include an evaluation of electric power plants on climate change, which they have not done previously. Part two, the Public Service Commission is the governing entity with responsibility for oversight and regulation for public service companies like Pepco and BG&E. In a case a couple of years ago, the PSC opined that it did not have the legal authority to include the impact on the climate crisis as part of its decision-making process. So under the bill, the Public Service Commission, in its regulating of the public service companies, will now have to consider the impact of climate effect and greenhouse gas emissions in their regulation of those entities. The third part, the PSC is also the lead agency in the state for licensing the siting, construction, and operation of power plants through what are called Certificates of Public Convenience and Necessity, or a CPCN. Under the bill, the PSC will not be able to act on a CPCN without first considering the effect of climate change on the project, as well as for generating stations and transmission lines, and what impact they will have on greenhouse gas emissions. Now, this two-pronged approach really reared the importance of its value at the exact time that this bill was on the floor in the Senate. And that was in Texas, if you recall, this past winter, their grid came to a halt. It shut down because of a couple of issues. Climate change on their grid. Things have changed. They're getting winter where they didn't used to get winter. And so under this bill, we will now have to look at both what it is that these entities will do to the climate with their projects, as well as how will climate change affect how we deal with things like our electric grid. Finally, the bill addressed labor, the maintenance of fair and stable labor practices on the workforce with regard to the utility companies. And the reason for that is that over the last two decades, the utility companies have begun privatizing and contracting out a significant portion of the work they do. And so what we're starting to see is a race to the bottom to pay the least amount of money to get the work done, which then means we're not getting the best quality work. And when it comes to our utility infrastructure, it is very important that we ensure we are getting quality construction. And so this bill is addressing that. There was another bill that also required prevailing wages be paid in the state to any utility doing underground work because of this same situation. I very much and appreciate all the support that I got from the Sierra Club in working to get this legislation passed. Delegate Laura Charkoudian, who's done such great work this session on a number of environmental initiatives, did the cross file on this bill. She was my partner on it. We would be texting in real time when the bills were in committee and on the floor. And the very best part of it is, it makes the heads of my Republican colleagues just explode when we pass clean energy legislation, because they are just so committed to burning fossil fuels that it puts a smile on my face when we get these clean energy bills through. And with that, thank you very much for all the support from everyone, and enjoy the evening.
Thank you so much, Senator Kramer. We have now Martha Ainsworth, who will be introducing Delegate Regina Boyce. I'm not sure if Martha is having some tech issues. I've been trying to connect with her, so I'm just going to go ahead and request Delegate Regina Boyce to make her remarks.
Thank you so much, and thank you for having me during this celebration. This was a trying year, and it seemed like everything on the table was not only important, but important at the same priority level. And so as session goes, we did what we can do, and we always know it is next year. And so with that, I had the honor of sponsoring HB 127, which is the Maryland Paint Stewardship Bill, which would allow the paint care program to be established in Maryland. It would have been the 12th program in the last 10 years that would be in Maryland. And it's a program that essentially pays for itself, pays for its service to manage post-consumer paint. It is what we call an EPR, an extended producer responsibility. And why it's important, and most importantly, why it works, is because the industry, the manufacturers, has said, you know, we've got 10% of post-consumer paint ends up in landfills and in our incinerators, and we can recycle 85% of that. And what this bill does is it puts a fee determined through a plan submitted to MDE to on paint, a pint up to 5 gallons each. And that fee will then create the program that is essentially doesn't necessarily make money, but it makes just enough money to manage the program. And what that means is, I think, which makes people excited, because I know it makes me excited. It means that, you know, when you've got leftover paint, I've been in my house 17 years next year, I definitely have between paints and stains and varnishes, probably 20 cans. And it's been there. And what happens is it stays there until I have a Baltimore City Household Hazardous Waste Day where I can take those cans to there, or a dumpster day where I can drop those off. But the majority of those, probably half of what I have, can be reused. And so what this program does is it sets up those sites so that at any time, if they make they have a relationship with Lowe's or a Home Depot or your local Ace or your local hardware store, at any time you can drop that paint off. You don't have to wait for those days. That's 365 days a year that you can drop that off, and the program will collect it. And most of it gets recycled. You know, we're talking about reuse. Some of you maybe have a second chance of a business within your communities where you can take stuff like paint. You know, some of us have been in those hardware stores and you buy the oops paint, the paint that, you know, you thought you were buying Kelly Green and it looks like moss green, and you turn it back and you pay a smaller fee for it, but it becomes paint on my wall. That's a source of recycling of paint. And so it didn't make the finish line, but I can say in 2017, this bill came before the House and the Senate, sponsored then by Delegate Lafferty and also and then Senator Joan Carter Conway, and didn't make it. And they went back to the drawing board and worked for years on it, and they brought it back and they talked to my chair of the best committee in the House, Environment Transportation. They said, we want to bring this bill back. Who do we give it to? And then he said, oh, give it to Delegate Boyce. Okay. And so it has been certainly a passion. It's certainly last year didn't make it out because of COVID. And this year, I mean, the success of it is that it is not cross-filed and that it actually made it to third reader in the Senate. And so when I've got champions like Senator Pinsky on the line here, I know someone like him is going to help get it across the finish line next year. And so we're going to refile. It's I would say perfect in its writing, but I can't thank the Sierra Club enough. I think Martha and I are like new best friends. She sent me emails, she called me, she met with me, her and the Zero Waste team. What can we do? How can we do it? And I just let her know, for, you know, it is session, it is what happens. There are fighting priorities. And while it is a priority, it wasn't the top priority. And so we're just looking to work with the House, work with the Senate again, and work with you all to make sure it definitely passes next year. I see a lot of commentary, try to follow it a bit here. Let me see if I can multitask here. I see, oh, there's Martha. Do you want to say something, Martha? You're on.
Thank you so much, Delegate Boyce. This was a wonderful bill and it almost made it over the finish line. So kudos to you. And you were spectacular as a floor manager too.
Thank you. Thank Chairman Barbray, who said, wait a minute, you're on the floor? That's good to know. And then my life changed. And so certainly a fun task to be able to defend bills like, you know, Delegate Solomon's bills or Delegate Learman's bill or Delegate, Vice Chair Stein's bills. It's certainly an honor and a privilege, because what you know is you're putting your best foot forward for somebody else's good work, hard work. And so I was honored to do that. And so again, thank you guys so much. Thank you. This is a victory, even though it didn't get across the finish line. But again, it made it by itself, single filed, all the way to third reader. And so we're just hoping to push that again. I'm doing more work next session, working with the industry, having more of them come out to talk about the fact that they have done this. And quite frankly, it has been, and Martha can testify to this, it's been an example for a lot of other potential EPR bills. Delegate Hill had a bill for mattress recycling and has then used my bill as a template to create a mattress bill. And so that would somewhat do the same thing. But I think why this bill works the best is because it's an actual product and it's the actual manufacturer saying that we can manage our own stuff, and we need more people to, more industry to do that, either stop making the junk that's killing our environment or decide that there is a second life and there's a way that we can reuse it. And so I'm excited about it again, you know, I guess 1, 2, 3, 4 times a charm. And I'm looking forward to the support of advocates and the support of the Sierra Club and Martha pushing me all the way.
Thank you so much, Martha and Delegate Boyce.
Thank you.
And now we are going to be hearing from some folks about the transportation bills. So we thought we'd start off with a trivia question about electric cars. And this one is a multiple choice because we have two correct answers out of these possible six. So make your guesses. right. Four more seconds. Okay, so here we have our answers. All right, so those of you who answered, the 31% of you who answered Senator Kramer, yes, he does own an electric car. Delegate Mark Corman does not. Delegate Brooke Learman does. I see she was quite a clear front runner there. Senator Corey McRae does not. Delegate Jared Solomon does not. And Senator Paul Pinsky has a hybrid, but we were not counting that among our electric car winners, but just so that you all know, he does have a hybrid. And without further ado, now I believe it's Lindsay who's going to speak about, introduce the transportation bills.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm so excited that I've gotten to work with Senator Corey McRae, Delegate Jared Solomon. Y'all are just amazing people, have done so much great work in the General Assembly. And oh my gosh, I could just go on for hours, but I know we're limited at time. So I'll just say real quick that among a lot of amazing bills that they sponsored, Senator Corey McRae sponsored the Transit Safety and Investment Act that helped close the gap in the MTA's maintenance backlog, and it passed the General Assembly this year, so exciting. Delegate Jared Solomon, who sponsored legislation for a one-seat MARC ticket from Nova to or Maryland to Northern Virginia, and also sponsored legislation to challenge the I-495 and I-270 project. And finally, Delegate Mark Corman, who wasn't able to attend the full meeting, but popped in at the beginning, who also sponsored legislation to electrify MTA's transit fleet and also a bill challenging the I-495 and I-270 expansion project. So with that, I'll turn it over to Senator McRae and Delegate Solomon.
Lindsay, just want to say thank you for the warm introduction. First, I just want to say that it's a privilege and honor to be here with the Sierra Club family, also to be joined definitely by the rock star, Jared Solomon, who I was able to work with the lead bill. And we were like inner chatting in the Zoom about how proud we were that it got signed today. I'm also happy to be joined by a number of my colleagues. I see a number of senators. I will get in trouble if you do not name all of them, so I won't start. But I did learn a lot from these questions in reference to, I did not know that my buddy, Ben Kramer had all of those swords over there. I got a kick out of the 0% for the electric car. Everybody was right, but that was fun. And yes, I was a newspaper deliverer as my first job. So that was pretty cool. So just thank you. I cannot just elaborate how much of a pleasure it was to work with Lindsay. I'm an organizer at heart, and she is one of the best. And one of the things that I think about, especially working on Senate Bill 199, House Bill 114 with my crossfile, Brooke Learman, that this was fun because this actually brought along an untraditional coalition. So when you think about the environment and labor, our civil rights organizations, our all of our jurisdictions, from our mayor from the city of Baltimore, Johnny O, Calvin Ball, Stuart Pittman, but even crossing over into our DC Metro jurisdiction with Mark Ehrlich and so many others that just joined in on this coalition, Regina, it was so surprising and so invigorating to be able to work on this. And as Lindsay's talked about, that backlog. So let me put this back into perspective. Many people do not own a regular car, electric car, or any car at all. And we should always be reminded of that, that public transit is the only option for a number of our families, especially those that need it the most. And then when we think about who's catching public transit, let's try to bring it back home and center back on the focus. It's our young people that catch public transit just to go to school. It's our seniors that's catching public transit just to go and get prescription drugs, doctor visits, et cetera, et cetera. Let's think about those families that do not have healthy food options in their immediate neighborhood, but have to get on public transit in order to get those healthy food options. Let's think about workers that need to get to work and shouldn't have to take an hour, an hour and a half to get there. I'm thankful for the leadership of the Sierra Club and so many folks that realized that this was an important lift. And let me be clear, I knew it was an important lift because they were reaching out to me like every 30 minutes, every hour because of this virtual session. Instead of coming to the office, it was a lot of just strategic puzzling to make sure that we can, and in the House, I should be clear, let me tell you, all of my House of Delegate members were leaders on this last year. It was the Senate that had to get this across the finish line. And that does not happen without the leadership of Senate President Bill Ferguson, our Chairman of Budget and Tax, Guy Gazzone, which was the respective committee that it had to get across. And then I'm getting calls even today that's talking about, did the governor sign? Is he going to let it just go into law? Just making sure that we can hit that trigger, that 85 votes in the House of Delegates and that 29 votes in the Maryland State Senate. So if we have to, let's hope we do not, but if we have to, that we can go for that override. So just making sure that can happen, but that does not happen without the organizing that happened to make sure that we got that across the finish line. So I say thank you, thank you, thank you. I hope I was not too long-winded, but I just wanted to say this was one of the funnest bills to be able to work on in my legislative career, and that was fun because you were there. Thank you.
I hate following my good friend Senator McCray, but it is it's a pleasure to be here with you all. And Lindsay, thank you to you and the whole team, Josh and Paula in particular. And I see so many constituents on with us tonight. You all are amazing. There's almost so many bills to too many bills to mention. But I'll touch on sort of the two that Lindsay mentioned that I had the pleasure of sponsoring this year. Or one from last year, we started off the session by overriding the governor's veto on the MARC run-through bill. And I think, to Senator McCray's point, it's great to start talking about, the potential of expanding MARC service. I think there's so much potential in our regional rail, but we can't even talk about expanding service if we can't run the service we have existing right now in a way that allows people to actually use it. And so, Senator McCray's legislation, along with, Delegate Learman, is just so critical. Delegate Corman often says it's sort of the eat your vegetables legislation, because we've got to make sure that the service we have now works the way it's supposed to before we can even think about expanding and getting other people to be able to use it. So that bill was just so important. The P3 Oversight and Reform Act, which is, the bill that Lindsay and Paula and Josh and the whole team primarily focused on this session that I was sponsoring, we didn't get it over the finish line. But we still had a huge impact. And before I get to sort of the details, I would be remiss if I didn't thank Chairman Barvey and Senator Pinsky, Chair Pinsky, who are on. Chair Barvey in particular has been just a huge champion of P3 oversight, in the 3 years that we've worked on this issue, really since day one of, the governor's boondoggle, announcing widening of 270 and 495. And he's helped us shepherd this legislation through the House. This is the first year that the bill was referred to Senator Pinsky's committee, and he was a huge champion in getting it through actually twice through his committee, both the Senate version and the House version. And I don't believe Senator Rosa Pepp is with us tonight, but he was my Senate crossfile. The bill got further, frankly, than it ever had before. It would bring really sensible oversight protections and financial oversight protections to the P3 process that, as we see with the Purple Line, which is so critical to get built, but it's really been bogged down by mismanagement. We think this bill is just common sense. It would not stop the current Beltway project, but it would bring real important reform to the process. But I think what's really critical to point out here is the work that we all have done. Many of us, I think we started this even before I was technically elected in 2018, has made a huge impact. The governor announced, just last week, that he is pulling, three quarters of the Beltway out of the environmental impact statement, the environmental impact study that's being done on the sort of was originally being done on the full Beltway and is being pulled out. We still have a lot of work to do to make sure that the segment that remains in there is done properly, limits the environmental impact, focuses on transit, focuses on, really a feasible construction plan, that doesn't necessarily turn over public goods to private entities. But the fact that we have been able to pull probably the most environmentally damaging pieces out of this project just goes to show the incredible power that you all have. It's not certainly because the governor is listening to Chair Barvey and I rail on the floor of the House. It's because he's being inundated by constituents and residents across, really across the state, but across Montgomery and Prince George's County in particular, and Frederick, talking about how important it is to sensibly plan for our transportation future. And so You know, we didn't get the bill through this year. We're going to bring it back next year. You know, regardless, again, of this project, we need to make sure we've got oversight in place for our P3 law. And I just really want to thank, you know, everybody who's here tonight for all your help and support, because we wouldn't be able to do what we do without you all.
Thank you so much. And with that, I would like to introduce Delegate Brooke Learman, who represents the 46th District in Baltimore. After spending 5 years as a member of the Appropriations Committee in the General Assembly, she assumed a leadership role on the Environment and Transportation Committee in 2019. She also sits on the Joint Committee on Ending Homelessness, the Oversight Committee on Pensions, and founded and co-chairs the Maryland Transit Caucus. Delegate Learman was not able to join today's event, but she certainly has shared a video that we will be sharing with you now.
Hi, I'm Delegate Brooke Learman, and I'm so sorry that I can't be with you this evening. It's a crazy month, but I wanted to make sure that I could stop by and just say thank you. I can't thank you enough, honestly, for the leadership, for the work, for the commitment that the leadership of the Sierra Club, that the grassroots members of the Sierra Club, that everybody in the Sierra Club put forward over the past year. You know, this session was really unparalleled in terms of the progress that we made in so many areas of environmental law, from transit. Even though we didn't pass the plastic bag ban, we made great strides passing it through one chamber. I'm just so, so grateful for the work of the Sierra Club and all that you do. I wanted to make sure that I could be on here to express that to you. I'm grateful as a legislator, as a mom, as a candidate for statewide office, just to know that you and your membership are all over the state, you know, doing work in our communities each and every day, and then also trying to change the narrative and pass important statewide policy that'll create a cleaner and healthier environment for our kids, future generations, and for us. So please keep up the work. We need you. Thank you so much for all you do. It's always such a joy and such an honor to partner with you on this work. Thank you so, so much.
Thank you, Delegate Learman. And with that, I would like to introduce Senator Paul Pinsky, who represents the 22nd District in Prince George's County. He became a member of the Maryland Senate in 1994 after serving two terms in the House of Delegates. He serves as Chair of Education, Health, and Environmental Affairs Committee. I also want to recognize and introduce Chairman Kumar Barve, who will be sharing remarks after Senator Paul Pinsky. Chairman Barve was the first Indian American elected to serve in a state legislature in United States history. He has represented Montgomery County District 17 in the Maryland House of Delegates, and he's the chairman of the House Environment and Transportation Committee. Back to you, Senator Paul Pinsky.
Thank you, Shruta. First of all, thank you for what you do, for mobilizing people, educating people, engaging people, which leads me to a point I want to underline that Jared, Delegate Solomon, talked about, and that is the governor's retreat on part of the road widening project on the 495 Beltway. That clearly only came about because of mass opposition from grassroots, from organizations like Sierra Club, like-minded legislators. We're not done yet, but we should really take pride in that victory. You know, we understand the destruction that putting tens of thousands of new cars on the Beltway and on the roads will have to the environment, and that we have to stress mass transit, public mass transit. And again, it's a victory people should celebrate tonight. We're not done. We still should have mass transit along 270. We should have a bus lane or light rail from Frederick to Shady Grove. There are lots of solutions, but the governor is a Neanderthal and his administration has no vision for the future. And that sort of is a good segue to addressing climate change. I've sat on the Climate Commission for numbers of years, and I, as well as other advocates, am very frustrated. There's a lot of talk, but very little action. It's low-hanging fruit, but unfortunately, over the long term, we just can't rely on low-hanging fruit. We have to be bolder. We have to address climate change in a fairly aggressive way. which led us to introduce the Climate Solutions Now Act, which many of you are familiar with. It took us 6 months to a year to write the bill, and it ended up being a pretty sweeping bill, from requiring a 60% reduction by 2030 to carbon neutral by 2045, to planting 5 million trees across the state, with 10% being in urban areas that have been disproportionately hit by climate change. And again, even planting trees serves a dual purpose. It absorbs carbon dioxide, as many of you know, and it also helps runoff into the bay. So it helps clean up the bay as well. It had many other aspects, building codes, because a lot of energy is lost in our large buildings, electrifying the state fleet of passenger cars and buses, having schools solar ready or carbon neutral, and also paying a much greater attention of environmental justice. It's all been talked for many years. There's been a commission that's been moribund. We wanted to say it had to do significant things to find out how much is being spent in underserved areas, in disproportionately affected areas, to put a very sharp lens that any of our work on climate, public health, everything else should be looked at through the lens of how it affects environmental justice. The other aspect of the Climate Solutions Now Act was having a thoughtful plan to transition and change our economy from one of dirty fuels to clean energy. It affects thousands of people. How do we make that change? How do we protect the workers who are affected? How do we retrain them? How do we grow the new sectors of the environment? It's not going to happen by itself. We propose putting the people in the room, the key stakeholders, the unions, management, the state, local governments, and figure out how do we do this over the next 5 or 10 years? How do we pay for it? It's not going to be cheap. So the bill was very widespread, and it's ironic. I read in this morning's Washington Post about some initiatives from the Biden administration, and one is about building codes. And they mentioned New York and Washington State, which have been leading in putting building codes in their state code. The new president wants to do it in all federal buildings going forward. Also expand heat pumps and a number of other clean energy sources or sources that can rely on clean energy rather than reinforce the old types of energy. So a lot of work went into this bill. A lot of people helped shape it. We passed it through the Senate, passed it on to the House. There are some differences of opinion, and it didn't get done. I'm hoping that we can put our minds together and get it done next year. Some people said, even if it's a partial part of the bill, we should accept it. But I have to remind people, if we would have passed a bill under the name Climate Solutions, but was not as bold as we need, we wouldn't have been able to come back next year. And so in my mind, it was better to step back, give it some thought, be bolder next year, actually come with like-minded views and try to pass one of the strongest bills in the country. That being said, in the waning days when it looked like this bill wasn't going to pass, I have to say we pulled a few rabbits out of the hat, and we amended the 5 million tree portion of the bill onto another tree bill in the last 48 hours of the session, which has now become law. We also, when the bill wasn't moving on electrifying the state bus fleet, there was a bill sitting around, Delegate Corman, who has been a friend and colleague as well as the Senate crossfile, and we moved that bill in about 24 hours. So when there's the will to get things done, it can get done. So we got two major portions done, which we should celebrate. I think we can all be disappointed we didn't get the bold sweeping bill that many of us wanted, but there's next year, and I look forward to working with all of you to building momentum to have thousands of people, tens of thousands of people demanding that we pass strong Climate Solutions Now Act, because we can't always rely on the federal government. I doubt if the filibuster is gonna be changed in the Senate. So at the moment, we still have to rely on states like New York, like Washington, and like Maryland. So I look forward to staying active and working with you. And as was said, as chair of the Environmental Committee in the Senate, we hear the most bills in the whole legislature. So trying to get to those key bills to clean up the environment, to make it a better quality of life for all Marylanders. It takes a lot of time and energy, and our committee, I think, did a great job in going through the thousands of bills to try to pass some of the crucial ones. We did not get all across the finish line, and hopefully those that fell short will take them next year. So thank you again.
Well, thank you. First of all, I want to thank the Sierra Club for the tremendous work you've done with me and with others over many, many years. Working together over many years, we went from having 7.5% renewable energy in our energy grid to 20 to now almost 25% that's currently locked in and moving toward 50%. We banned fracking, which is a tremendous victory. We actually, I had a bill that you helped me with 3 years ago that functionally bans offshore oil drilling. And, you know, all of these victories occurred because we worked together collaboratively, and we always understood that for a law to make sense and to advance the frontiers of a clean energy, that we have to be practical and measurable. And we've always done that. I'm going to make a commitment to you right now. This interim, my committee and my vice chair, Dana Stein, are committed to working with engineers, architects, economists, labor unions, and people who represent the African-American community and the Latino community to put together a truly bold piece of legislation that will make, once again, put Maryland at the forefront of environmental cleanup, especially with respect to building codes, especially with respect to new technologies, especially with respect to full vehicle electrification, not just cars, but also light duty trucks and buses, light duty trucks and heavy trucks as well. And another thing that we have to do as a community of environmentalists is we have to make sure that while we are very excited about clean energy, we in Maryland have to actually generate clean energy. I want to thank the Sierra Club for the stance you've taken with respect to local governments who have in some cases been very short-sighted in regulating to death community solar. That's a problem that really has to be addressed at the state level. And I look forward to working with you to make sure that short-sighted local governments don't cut the legs out from under us by making it difficult or illegal to have solar energy in terrestrial siting around the state of Maryland. And so I look forward to working with you as these public hearings and briefings are scheduled. I will be sure to include you. If you know engineers, people who have real experience, hard experience in HVAC, in geothermal, in large and small and medium building construction, I want to hear from you and I want to have their names because they're going to be brought in here. At the end of the day, I will say that I don't know who said this, but it's been said that if you can't measure it, you can't improve it. You have worked with me and with so many other people to make sure that we have the ability to pass environmental laws and regulations that are very hardened down into specific numbers so that we can measure specific milestones. And that's what I intend to do between now and the beginning of the January session. So again, thank you very much. And who knows, maybe I'll be able to pass my little bill that makes it illegal for gas cars to park in electric car charging spots. Who knows? My wife and I, by the way, both own electric cars, so there. So thank you so much, and I look forward to working with you over the next several months.
Thank you so much, Senator Pinsky and Chairman Barve. We are happy to have you here. I have a couple more thank yous that we have before we wrap up here. And we wanted to make sure that we recognized our district captain coordinator, Steve and Sandy Foote, and all of our district captains. What you're seeing on your screen now is a list of all of the district captains who worked. We could not get lobby week or lobby night done without all of these folks who help coordinate constituents to go and speak to all of the legislators. So thank you, thank you, thank you to everybody who has stepped up to help on that front. And we also want to give a quick shout out thank you to Jen Brock Cantillari, who helped us out this evening behind the scenes. And we're going to finish off with one final trivia question. I want to say thank you to everybody who, all of the delegates and senators who responded to all of these silly questions that we asked them, and who have, I hope, that made it more fun this evening with you having these trivia questions to answer. So we're going to wrap up with this one, and then we have a few final closing remarks from Rosa Hance and Shruti Bhatnagar after we reveal the answers to this. And again, on this question, these are all something that somebody witnessed who answered our polling. So it's just your best guess.
Oh, this is an easy one.
There's a story. I think you need to tell it, Chairman Barbe.
Which story? There are too many.
Okay, and here we are wrapping up with our polling. Okay, so the 40% of you who answered, someone give an entire presentation while driving to their daycare and dropping off their kids, is correct. That is what Delegate Mark Corman witnessed. Senator Paul Pinsky saw a witness hiding in the shadows while testifying. Senator Ben Kramer has his own 80-pound Doberman jumps up on his lap and kisses him while he's testifying or speaking. And Delegate Brooke Learman enjoys Carl Anderton's virtual backgrounds. And I'm sure many others do as well. So thank you so much. And over to you, Rosa, or Shruti, or whoever's going next.
Thanks so much, Julia. This was a lot of fun. I definitely have learned a lot about our legislative champions here, and all the things that you've gotten up to over your careers and over this very strange year of Zoom. So thank you all again for sticking with us and coming both tonight and just throughout the 2021 Maryland legislative session. The 90 days is both somehow a sprint and marathon. Even during a pandemic with shifting work and family life balances and child care, elder care, and I know the impact of illness and loss on our mental health and the heartbreak, both personal, professional, and watching our country's democratic institutions become threatened gravely by force, you all looked out for each other. You all looked out for clean air that we can breathe, clean water that we can drink and play in, sustainable communities, Maryland's beautiful forests, wetlands, rivers, mountains, and bay. And so thank you for looking out for our earth and each other. Thank you for writing and signing letters and emailing and calling your legislators, Zooming, testifying, all the YouTube hearings, millions of tweets and comments and shares, and because you all raised the profile of environmental and justice issues at a time that it could have been very easy to ignore, be distracted and busy and overwhelmed. So every little bit that you all did this year, both as humans and as advocates and as legislators, we appreciate it from the Maryland Sierra Club and from my heart to yours. So we hope that you'll continue to
join us and support our organization as we endeavor to explore, enjoy, and protect. That's our motto, Sierra Club's motto, our beloved coastal state, because there's always more to do, as you've seen tonight. I hope you get involved, stay involved, and remember that there's always an election around the corner. And we need more environmental champions to invite to our legislative victory party in 2023. So when you consider a donation of any size, shape, or type, remember that the Sierra Club Maryland chapter accepts C4 donations, C3 gifts to the Sierra Club Foundation, and that we have actually a statewide PAC for political action, and that can ultimately be given to candidate contributions as we approach those endorsement and election times. So every dollar that you support goes directly into our work, supporting our wonderful, amazing staff and volunteer coordination around the state. We're all working hard and sometimes after bedtime as advocates for our environment and our home. So thank you all again for your generosity of spirit and your support and your time, and have a lovely evening, and I hope to see you again very soon. And I'll hand it back to Shruti Bhatnagar for closing remarks.
Thank you, Rosa. And I just want to wrap up on behalf of Julia and me to thank everyone for joining us to celebrate the 2021 Legislative Victory Party. As Rosa said, please continue to stay engaged. Check out the Sierra Club calendar for our events throughout the year. We also encourage you to invite friends, especially youth who may be home for the summer from college, or high schoolers who want to participate and attend one of our volunteer orientation sessions to learn about the many opportunities that are there to get involved with Sierra Club. We look forward to staying connected until the next legislative session. And as we end this event, I want to thank Lindsay Mendelson and Gary Young for their tech support today. A huge shout out to all our legislators, and I'm putting the name in the chat once more. Thank you all so much for your efforts in the General Assembly session and for attending this event. So thanks everyone, have a wonderful evening and a wonderful summer.